happened is I'd had 6 inches of colon removed. It was a colon resection because of diverticulitis. And, you know, doctors will lie to you about how long you're going to be laid up. You know, they'll say 2 weeks, add 50%. And so, you know, 3 weeks after that, I'm lying in bed. I'm still in tremendous pain. And I think I was about three quarters awake and lying on my bed. And I look over to the bedroom door. And in the bedroom door, suddenly, in multicolored armor instead of the whole white. And he came over to my bed and he took a knife and stabbed it into the place where the pain was. And I was shot through with this tremendous pain, and I sat straight up in the bed, which I hadn't been able to do. And I thought it was a demon, and I started rebuking it. I started saying, you know, get out of here in the name of Jesus. And then I realized, oh, there's no pain. And I didn't have any pain after that. So this crazy angel.
Well, I understand that because of the way God has touched you, that sometimes in your home congregation, you pray and as many as 70% get healed.
I asked my people, because we were talking about healing, and I said, how many of you that are part of this church have experienced a healing while you were here? And I'm guessing 70% of their people, of my people, raised their hands.
Now, I would say there's a lot of glory in his congregation.
I was surprised.
Speaking of glory, you had a vision of the field of oil.
Yeah, and that one just came on me suddenly. It was a sudden sense of this tremendous, heavy, thick love of God. It was a beautiful, sweet anointing, and it was like the Lord was pouring over my head and over the head of the church this thick, thick, thick oil. I mean, we're talking an inch thick, and it rolled down, and when it hit the floor, it began to spread out. And this is what I saw. I saw that what God wants to do in this time, and this is available for any believer that gets ready. Mm-hmm. I saw that God wants to pour such a presence on us, such a glory, such an anointing for healing and restoration, that we so radiate the love of the Father and the presence of God, that when we come in contact with people in the world who've been so deluded to think that darkness is light, when people are exposed to the pure light and presence of Jesus, darkness is exposed to be light. And people say, I want what you have. When people come in contact with my 46-year marriage, your 53-year marriage, and they see the glory that God has put on us, and they look at their own lives, then they begin to say, how did you get there? And then they feel the love flowing off of us. I believe that people ought to, I don't believe that you know, when Peter walked through a crowd, and his shadow fell on people, they got healed. Just from his shadow. I don't believe that was only for Peter. I believe that's where God wants us to walk. And I believe that if we'll receive it, those kinds of things will happen. That oil will flow off of us.
You talk about essential things in preparation.
Yes.
And one thing you talked about that really hit me, the need for hunger for God.
Yes.
Comment on that.
Yeah, I will comment on that. When things get easy, like right now, in a season of favor, it's really easy for us to fall asleep. We get lulled. You know, that sometimes I think that prosperity is a poison to the body of Christ. But right now, this season of prosperity is a time to prepare. It's a time to get out of debt. It's a time to seek after God. It's a time to cultivate our hunger for God. I am going to seek after God. That is a decision of my will because I need him. That's the beginning. I'm not going to ignore my hunger for God. I don't care what I'm feeling. I'm seeking after God. That's a covenant. There are certain covenants I will not renegotiate in my life. One of them is my covenant with my wife. I will never renegotiate that. And the other is my covenant with God. No matter what comes against me, I will not renegotiate that covenant. The second thing, there are three parts to that, I think, and they're so simple, three parts. The second thing is we've got to start hungering after the Word. The two least attended meetings in any church, our prayer and Bible study. And I came through the Jesus movement, and I remember everything back then was the Word, the Word, the Word, the Word. You never went anywhere without your sword. And now, Bible study? No, everybody wants an experience. And so we have a whole generation of biblically illiterate Christians who will buy anything that's said to them because they don't know the Word. You know, the Word is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing as far as the division of soul and spirit. You put that Word into you, and it works. It begins to change you.
So going back to what you said, if I don't feel like reading the Bible, So what? It's living, it's alive, it's coming into me. If the word is Jesus,
right,
why would I reject Jesus?
Exactly.